Johann Heinrich Pestalozzi was a Swiss educator and social reformer who came to be known as the father of modern education. His ideas caught on in Europe in the early 19th century and began to transition the traditional systems of education in place there. As an educator, his doctrine and his core beliefs sit very close to my heart because they're based upon two fundamental principles that educators subscribe to. The first of those is that all human beings can learn, regardless of background, regardless of gender, regardless of socioeconomic status, rich or poor, race, ethnicity, it doesn't matter. All human beings can learn. And number two, that all human beings have the right to an education. As these two ideas spread throughout Europe, education gradually became available to an increasingly diverse number of children. Now, Pestalozzi, who hailed from the feudal systems in Switzerland, believed that regardless of wealth, all children should receive an education. Now, indeed, many would argue that this was the primary means for a child to rise above his or her station. And Pestalozzi argued that for these children in particular, education needed to be relevant to their culture and as well as to their daily lives to be useful. He stated that education needed to equip these students with the tools that they would need to function from day to day. Now, for idealistic Americans in a very new country, the Pestalozzi's educational philosophies align clearly with the notion that the individual is indeed important. And after all, it was the Pilgrims who first colonized this new nation who came to find their own way with regards to religious beliefs and political beliefs and believed that, you know, one religion didn't fit everybody. Well, as an extension of that, surely then, the individualization of a child's education, one that's based upon love and understanding, was equally important. Now, in addition to these ideas, Pestalozzi insisted that education needed to serve the development of head, heart, and hands. The process of empowering students in these three dimensions would enable them to not only make correct and appropriate moral judgments, but it would also enable them to feel liberated and enabled to act, taking response to various situations that occur throughout their lifetime, and thus being able to bring peace and social justice to all communities. Many schools worldwide subscribe to Pestalozzi's ideas, and most strive to base their educational philosophies and principles upon his teachings. Now, whereas this may not be globally true, in more developed nations we certainly see this as the case. Now, with regard to music, Pestalozzi saw its value, but he did not incorporate the subject into his particular educational system. Pestalozzi was never a music teacher. It was something he enjoyed, but it was not part of his core educational plan. So, as his ideas began to catch on in traditional American educational systems, different groups saw the use of these principles and began to apply them to other realms as well. The best known case of this is in the case of the Boston Public School Committee, who, when making the decision as to whether or not to include music education in the basic daily curriculum in Boston Public Schools, decided that yes, it would be an appropriate thing to do. And that decision was, in fact, partially influenced by the ideas and teachings of Pestalozzi, that being that music was, in fact, socially and culturally relevant and therefore appropriate for classroom instruction. Now, the American music educator William Channing Woodbridge studied music education in Europe in the early 1800s, and as part of his education there, observed a few different music educators, but one in particular by the name of Hans Georg Nageli, who was a colleague and a pupil of Pestalozzi, stood out in particular. In fact, Nageli was often thought of as a disciple of Pestalozzi, and he was responsible for the incorporation of Pestalozzi and instructional principles in different music schools throughout Switzerland. Now, after Woodbridge's time in Europe, he came back to America having seen all these different ideas put into action, learning about means to implement them in the music classroom, and upon returning to America saw that what we did here was not necessarily best practice, it wasn't as effective as possible. And seeking to improve upon that, he became a champion of Pestalozzian ideology in the music education classroom. Now, although he implemented these ideas in terms of singing, because instrumental music education wasn't really in place in American public schools until much later, he still was able to incorporate seven basic principles, tenets, if you will, which he brought back with him from Europe, that worked in terms of not only the singing approach to music education, but would work in an instrumental setting as well. And the seven principles are as follows. Number one, teach sounds before signs. A child must sing before learning notation or pitch names. Number two, the teacher should lead the child to observe through listening and through imitating sounds, noting their similarities and their differences, without having these ideas explained to him. This increases the rigor of the activity, which therefore leads to active as opposed to passive listening. Number three, that we should teach one concept at a time. Rhythm, melody, and expression are taught separately before being used in combination. Number four, children must practice each of these concepts, rhythm, melody, and expression, until they can demonstrate full mastery prior to moving on to the next skill. Number five, give the principles and theory after practice. These are taught as something which leads to other things. In Michael Mark's Concise History of American Music Education, he refers to this as an inductive manner of introducing principles and theory. Number six, that we should analyze and practice elements of articulate sound, and then demonstrate proficiency in transferring these into musical contexts. And then number seven, that we should have the names of the notes correspond to those used in instrumental music. Woodbridge then met up with Connecticut native Elam Ives Jr., who was an American music educator who actually was the first to implement Pestalozzian principles in the music education classroom, at least in America. Ives' approach with his students produced overwhelmingly positive results, and his collaborative efforts with Woodbridge, which were known as the Hartford Experiment, yielded amazing results, and it was an experiment that they devised utilizing 70 volunteer students from the Hartford, Connecticut area, and in transferring and translating European material for them, taught these students to sing, taught them about music, reading music, theory for music, based on those seven principles listed above and other Pestalozzian theory. And by the end of the experiment, not only were the children surprised by how well their performance ability increased, but it was also a surprise to their parents, to their administration, as well as to Ives and Woodbridge. It was an overwhelming success of an experiment, and so following that, Woodbridge returned to his home and began to spread word of the success and how well these philosophies and ideas work and how effective and how efficient they can make a classroom run. And as word began to spread, Ives found himself in a state of popularity as a well-known name for this movement and as a historical figure. Ives then progressed and went on to write two musical textbooks, the first of which was known as the American Elementary Singing Book, and this was actually the first American music text to incorporate Pestalozzian ideals, and not just to incorporate them, but also to advocate for their usage. A few years later, Lowell Mason collaborated with Ives. This was his second major collaboration, and the product that they created was known as the Juvenile Lyre, and that was a second text for singing. And the former of the two methods, again, was the first to idealize Pestalozzian ideals, the second of which took those ideals and just went a little bit further with them, developed them more, and gave more extra material for classroom usage. Now, the writing and publication of these two volumes, plus their popularity, actually cemented Ives's position in American music history as a very significant figure in the evolution and development of American music education. Now, why was this approach to music education so popular? I feel that the answer to this lies in America's musical education history, and that goes all the way back to colonial times. You see, early American colonists lacked musical training to such a severe extent that the church actually made a conscious effort to try to teach their congregation members to read and sing music at sight, not to mention to understand the technique of singing itself. Now, even then, these people who were common, they struggled to learn, as the means through which the singing and the music in general was taught was neither accessible nor relatively or any kind of relevant to their lack of educational background as well as to their culture. In modern time, we are well aware that relevance is a key strategy. It's known as a best practice for learning, but it's also a key factor in an individual's ability to process and internalize new material. Now, what made Pestalozzi's educational ideal so enticing then to these early American music educators was not only the careful pacing and structuring of the material that was being presented, but also it was the custom framework through which this material was taught. Much like we as educators use an IEP, which is an individualized education plan, to help assure that our students with special needs receive the services and the assistance that they require to be successful in our classrooms, these teachers developed the means to teach music such that students could quickly and successfully create a positive product, and all the while they were teaching and nurturing those upper-level thinking skills we know are crucial and are in our best practice. The analysis and synthesis and evaluation levels from Bloom's taxonomy were certainly still present, but the more basic levels of knowledge and comprehension and application were present as well. And Pestalozzi's ideals, and especially those seven principles I listed earlier, married together very, very well to cover that full spectrum that we use in Bloom's taxonomy to present material to students and to make sure that they're processing and internalizing it well. And this particular philosophical approach to teaching, therefore, incorporates a wider foundation of skills. And this allowed the learner to truly master the skill, the content, and the desired curriculum, the intended curriculum. Now, you know, as an educator of 15 years, a music educator of 15 years on this career path, I encounter a number of individuals, many of which are teachers, who look upon this type of education as some kind of newfangled, warm, fuzzy hippie nonsense. And I have to differ in opinion on that one. These ideas of tailoring education to fit the needs of our students, it's not some new idea. These are philosophies and ideas that have come from well over a century of educational research and evolution. We choose to adopt and employ these practices simply because we know that they work, and they work well for our students. We know they are the best things for our students. We know and we accept that all children can learn, but do all children learn in the same manner? And do they all learn at the same speed? Of course not. And does that mean that some children, because of that fact, should receive music instruction as part of their daily curriculum while others don't? Definitely not. What this does mean, however, is that we as educators must choose to create meaningful experiences for our students. And these must be meaningful experiences such that the musical skills that they gain during the time they're in our care are relevant to their own lives and can be practiced outside of the classroom. If they don't have the opportunity to use these skills, number one, there's no point in teaching them, but number two, they won't retain them. You see, perhaps learning about Bizet and opera could be good for some students who have grown up and in a realm where that's a common genre and they're exposed to that type of music. However, for many students, that's not the case. And, you know, perhaps it's just not pertinent to their life. Now, that doesn't mean that Bizet and opera aren't good things to teach, but you have to work your way up to that point. What this actually does mean is that a culturally appropriate song or piece of music might be a better selection. The Pestalozzian influence is everywhere, and it's not just in our music classrooms. We see it in math, we see it in English, we see it in science and social studies and in art, dance and theater. But it was a very slow introduction and seeping through the American music or the American educational system before Pestalozzian ideals became the dominant ideal. However, Elam Ives was a huge factor in these particular ideals being brought into our classrooms, as was Woodbridge, as was Lowell Mason. I think we would be in a very different place in American music education had Pestalozzi's ideals not swept through Europe as well as they did, and had American educators studied overseas in order to be exposed to these thoughts and to bring them over. Would we have reached these same ideas on our own? Well, that's possible. And it's even likely, given American thought and American culture. However, we definitely would not be at the same level of implementation in our classrooms. If that hadn't happened when it did, I think we'd be much further behind, and I don't think we would be as developed in those ideas if folks like Ives and Woodbridge and Mason hadn't brought those ideas over quite so soon and really pushed to make them part of our daily music educational experience. And how great for our students that they did.